my happy homesteading, homeschooling crew out there listening in. If this is your first time, welcome. If this is not your first time, welcome back. Today is episode number 27, which means for all you new folks out there, you can find the show notes at homesteadsandhomeschools.com/027. And if you've listened in for the other episodes and you couldn't remember, there it is for you now. My guest today is Mike Barnhouse of the Broken Shovel Farm. He and his wife have been homesteading for a number of years now. Started out kind of gardening, kind of expanding from there. And I had a chance to talk with Mike and find out what they do, find out how they move vegetables and produce, and talked a little bit about one of Mike's hobbies, which is roasting coffee, something that I have never really considered before, but I find to be very interesting and something I may have to do myself. We will see. Before we get into this too much further, if you heard some crickets in the background during this intro, that is because I am outside of my porch. So shoot me an email and let me know. Do you like this? Can you tell? Or is it just obnoxious background noise that makes it harder to understand? I don't know. Don't worry, the interview is not like this. So go back, re-listen to that intro. Let me know what you think. So let's put the crickets away. Let's go sow those Liberty seeds with Mike Barnhouse.
With a rose in and out of the garden he goes. Country garden in the wind and the rain. Wherever he goes, the people all complain. Stephen Osborne in his time. Well, he may and he may decline. Did it matter? Does it now? Stephen would answer if he only knew how.
So today my guest is Mike Barnhouse. He and his wife have a little homestead they got going on called Broken Shovel Farm, and they are in Joy, Illinois. So, Mike, thanks for taking the time today to come on and talk about your setup here.
Well, thanks a lot. I appreciate it.
So, looking at your Facebook, it seems that gardening, at least gardening, has been kind of in your blood for some time now. Is this something you guys have been doing for a while? You got raised up in it, or how did you guys get into the whole garden thing?
Yeah, both of us have been basically gardening since we were little. Our parents did. My great grandpa always had a garden, and I helped him with that when I was little, and my grandpa did. So it's just been a part of our lives for a long time. The year before we got married, we had a giant garden, and that basically kept us in food for our first year of college. So that was nice. They got sick of green beans, though.
Yeah. I know. You get going with a garden, and you think about it before you get it in. You know, you think that I'm going to have all this food, and then you do have all this food, but it's like you have so much cabbage, you just get sick of cabbage by like week three of cabbage or zucchini. You know, it's just. So yeah, but it does. It'll feed you. It'll feed you. Now, did you guys did you ever take a break? Because I feel like a lot of people that kind of get raised up having gardens and stuff, there's always a, you know, some sort of hiatus that in there that.
Yeah, we did. We went to school, and we kind of got distracted from all of that. We ended up. Both going to school. Neither one of us got a chance to finish because kids came along. So that kind of changed the game a little bit. And then, you know, we just got busy with life and bought our first house in Joy and lived in a really nice house on a super small space, which I thought was awesome because I didn't have any grass to cut and hardly at all and that sort of thing. And Robin started gardening with the kids just in a real small space to more as a science project for homeschool and that sort of thing. And things just changed over time, and we kind of come back to where we started and where we wanted to be. We just got distracted from it.
Yeah, it's tough, you know. I think that was kind of the route my parents went. When I was a kid, they had a garden, you know, when I was younger, and made some baby food and stuff like that. And then as the kids, guys, me and my brother got older, we kind of, you know, there's other activities, there's other things going on, there's all those distractions. And now that we're out of the house and the grandkids are around, I think they've started to put a few things in the ground, not what they had at any one point in time, but you know, but it is, the kids come around and throws you for a loop, you know?
Definitely.
So you guys, you incorporated that into, I guess, homeschooling a little bit. That was kind of,
yeah. Yeah. It was just a, you know, when especially when they're little, it's important for them to know how food, where their food comes from. You know, it doesn't just come out of the grocery store. And you know, it's a way to get them to try things too. I remember Sam, our youngest, he was so excited to try these Brussels sprouts. I mean, he was going to eat these Brussels sprouts. It was going to be awesome. And, you know, he was probably, I don't remember, two or three. He was still pretty little. He could say frouts. I think that's what he's called them. He was all excited about eating them. And Robin took real good care of them. And they were great. And he finally got a chance to taste them. And he looked at his mom. And he's this funny look on his face and like, yuck. And then he took another bite trying it, thinking, oh, it's got to be. He hated them.
Yep. Yep. Yeah, it's tough, you know, the little kids, they want to do it and then they have it. And it's just, what is this? What are you feeding me this? Why did I spend all this time doing that? You know?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
All right. So how long have you guys had your gardens back in and expanding?
Well, when we first bought this place, it was an acre of ground. And the second year we started a garden, basically just to feed us and give us, take care of the things that we wanted. Robin cans food for the winter and tomatoes and things like that. And so we started then, and then it just kind of grew and got a little bigger. And each year we added a little bit more, some more fruit trees or different things like that. And at some point in time, we just decided that, you know, I worked inside, in a factory for most of my life, and I kind of like being outside more than inside. And at some point in time, I want to be able to do that work outside. So this is just kind of a natural transition. We grow a lot of stuff for ourselves, so we thought we could grow some for some other people too. So
good deal. Did you say you were on an acre?
Yeah, when we started, we were on an acre.
Okay, and you're still in that same location now?
Yep. Still in the same corner, but last year we were able to buy 10 acres that were attached to this property. So now we're our own neighbors. So that's nice.
Nice, yeah. So how does that, when you were just on 1 acre, it was just gardens? Did you guys have any like chickens or anything like that? Any small livestock type stuff, or was it just a garden pretty much?
Yeah, we've had chickens since the second year that we moved here, and we do a few meat chickens each year. Mostly they're just for eggs, and we've had some ducks, and we have a couple of geese, and we have some Romanoff sheep now too. So they're a lot of fun.
Did you get the sheep before or after you expanded?
We got them the year before we expanded. Because my daughter had bought a small farm about 7 miles from us, and our plan was to take them over there once they got numerous. But we were able to buy this, and now we can keep them here. So it's kind of cool.
Nice. So when you were on that acre, how much food were you guys able to produce to kind of sustain you?
Lots. You can do a lot of food on an acre of ground. One of the books that we use as one of our reference guides is it's called The Market Gardener, and it's a French Canadian couple that they raise their farm's 2 acres of raised beds that they have. And I just saw some statistics here recently. One of their recent years, they made over $150,000 on that 2 acres of ground. And that's in Canada with a Canadian growing season. So it's doable. It's just an extreme amount of work. You know, there's no getting in your tractor and driving all day long. It's pulling weeds all day long, or, you know, bending over and raking, and then a lot of stuff that some people just don't want to do. So it's a different kind of deal, but you can grow a lot of food on an acre.
Yeah. It's, I'm trying to figure it out a little bit more. We're kind of a little bit more spread out, you know? And I know we could, I don't know if plant smarter is the right word, but, you know, kind of pack things in,
right,
and go a little more vertical. But you know, right now we're not hurting for space. We're, you know, so, but it is one of those interesting things. You're really, I'm always so impressed when I hear people on, you know, smaller acreage like that are able to produce the quantities that they do.
Right. Yeah. It's amazing.
So do you guys do much grocery shopping then, or is it kind of?
One of Robin's goals is to never shop again. That was one of her main goals, is never have to go to the grocery store again. Like, and that's not going to happen, obviously, because you know, you got to get oil, and you got to get salt and all those kind of things. But our shopping is curtailed quite a bit. We still buy meat and dairy and that sort of thing at the grocery store, but we very rarely buy anything that's already made. We're mostly just ingredient people, so you don't make the grocery store people too happy.
Yeah, you know. So as one of the other things I know you guys do, you kind of get into, you're into coffee a little bit. What exactly do you guys do with that? How do you, what's your coffee setup, I guess?
Well, when we first started off, you know, my favorite coffee is a Americano at Starbucks. Always fresh, always perfect. And it's also cheap compared to other Starbucks drinks. So, but, you know, when we drink a lot of coffee, and that's kind of why we started that, because, you know, at 10 or 12 bucks a pound for Starbucks, I thought, well, maybe I could do better, or, you know, at least get something that was, that we could tolerate, that we'd save a little bit of money and learn a new skill or something like that. So that's kind of how we started. And it's also, we also kind of did it as a prepper project too. You know, the beans in the green form last a really long time. They have a really long shelf life. So until you roast them, and then they'll deteriorate a little quicker. But, you know, they'd last a long time. So I thought, well, it's kind of a good blend of everything. I can keep coffee here, take care of us, and, you know, everything goes in the crapper, I'll have green gold in buckets. So,
yeah. where do you get it from? Do you have it shipped in, I imagine?
And... Yeah, we do. When we first started, we found a little company in Wisconsin called You Roast 'Em. And they sell, I think they sell 1, 5, or 25 pound packages of green coffees, and they get them in from all over the world. And it was a good place for us to start and try different ones. And so that was good. And then, we started roasting the first roasting I did was in a skillet on the stove, and I wouldn't recommend that because it's a smoky project. Robin's like, take it outside. She wasn't too happy with me. So, then we graduated from the skillet to a whirly popper, a popcorn popper, which does an excellent job on a small batch. Actually, you can really control. You can control what you're doing. And once you do it a couple times, you can make an excellent pound, basically half a pound of coffee and pretty quick, with a whirly popper. So we did that for a little while. And then, the first year Robin started farmers marketing in Aledo, we didn't have very much at the beginning of the season because we hadn't put any up our, cold houses yet or any of that sort of thing. So, she's like, why don't you make some coffee and we'll see if we can sell it. And people really liked it. So that's kind of how we got going doing it. So now we roast 5 pound batches. And it's still outside. One of these days I'm going to build me a building to roast indoors of some sort, not completely inside. But now I've just got a canopy that I put up if it's raining or something like that. Yeah, it's an outside project because it's super smoky. And the darker you make the coffee, the more smoke you get. So,
did you do a lot of reading or studying up beforehand? Or was this kind of like a, let's just give it a go and see how it works? I mean,
a lot of YouTube and some reading. And then Roasting's website's got some good info on there too, about what to do and different ways to do it. And but yeah, there's the internet's loaded down with great people out there that really know what they're doing a lot more than I do. I'm just a hack, but
it's impressive. That's neat. So you sell that on the internet and at farmers markets then?
We sell it online. We have a store. One of our kids said, why don't you guys make a store and put it on the internet? I'm like, okay. We kind of mostly did it just so that, you know, because farmers market lasts for a certain period of time during the year. And then we have people that were wanting to buy it the rest of the year. So we thought, well, would it be an avenue for people to get it? We also have it in some local stores around, and that's helped out a bunch with our sales too. But just basically once you get somebody started, you know, it's not like you're going to stop and start every 6 months. People don't stop drinking coffee in the winter. Actually, they drink more of it in the winter. So
yeah.
At least me anyway.
How is that getting it into the stores? Did you have to, was it just a conversation between you and the store owner? Was there any sort of like certification or somebody has to come by and check out your roasting?
No, nothing like that yet anyway. But the places that we're going are all small, and they're either like farmers market friends or people that were already buying it or that sort of thing. So pretty small yet. We haven't had any bigger things yet. At some point in time, we may go down that road, but hopefully by then I'll have a roasting facility that's not under a tent.
Well, you got the space now, you know. It's just
right.
Just one more project, right?
Just right. Just what I need.
Yeah, it's a never ending process. You know, there's always one project that needs to get done, and you think you're caught up, and then the stairs on the deck start rotting out. You know. Never ends. But so what else do you guys sell at the farmers market then? Just kind of surplus produce or?
Just different kind of produce. We've been working on that too. We do a winter garden, and that's probably our biggest, that's probably the biggest part of our profit's going to be built into that winter gardening. One, there's hardly, if any, competition except for the grocery store, and then no weeds. Most of the grasses and that sort of thing don't grow when it's cold, so you don't have any of that competition, and there's no bugs, which is nice. And you know, gardening in your coveralls might seem a little bit weird, but it's actually pretty nice. I kind of like it. So
when you say winter garden, what months do you are you able to keep it going
all winter? We're probably going to do, a shutdown like that starts, the first of the year, the first of January, and we'll probably shut down until the first of February. And it's all kind of dependent on the light. It's more sunlight than temperature. So once you get down to a certain amount of hours of sunlight, basically everything quits growing. It won't grow hardly at all. So, but it'll stay alive. We had spinach inside the cold house, and actually outside with just a row cover over it, that lived all the way through the winter. And we cut spinach and delivered it a good portion of the winter this year. So that was our first experiment on a bigger scale, and it worked really good. Spinach is an amazing plant.
Yeah, it's hardy stuff. It's not a big fan of the heat down here. I'm in Georgia, and it kind of, you know, peters out early, but you know, it is, and I was never like into the winter gardening too much up north. We always kind of thought about putting in a hoop house or a greenhouse, trying to get that going. We never did, but yeah, when things, you know, they slow down in the winter, and sometimes things stop growing in the winter, but they're in the ground, and as soon as it thaws, as soon as that sun rolls around, they're going and they're growing and they're ready to pop. And it's really impressive how much bigger things are that have overwintered, and then compared to things that you plant as soon as you can work the ground. You know, we did that this past year with some broccoli and stuff, and just it's amazing. But
yeah, it's awesome. And it's another thing too, you know, in the middle of July, everybody's got sweet corn and everybody's got this stuff and they've got that stuff. So it's a big competition thing too at that point in time. But, you know, when you're talking the second week of February, nobody's really got too much of nothing. So
now you guys have a winter farmer's market where you are?
What we started off with it, we called it a winter CSA, and nobody around here really knew what that was. So, one of our friends, Kayla, decided that a co-op would be a better way to describe it. And it's worked out actually pretty good. So we have we plan on eventually, having some of our other farmers market friends be able to, put some things in there too, things that they've got, available. So, and then just a email list basically that goes out once a week, with what we've got, and, people can order it that way. And when we first started, we were just going to do that through the winter and then just do farmers market over the summer. And we thought about it a little bit more. And, you know, one of the things that's really nice about this co-op thing is people can, we kind of know what we need to take to farmers market. We can have people's stuff already packed up and their stuff sitting off to the side, and they can just come and get their stuff from us and get whatever they want from everybody else. It helps us a bunch, and it keeps them from missing out on, you know, oh, you don't have any green beans left or something like that. If they order them beforehand, then yeah. So it's actually pretty neat.
Yeah. I like that. It's an interesting method. It's sort of almost like a hybrid between sort of the CSA and the just going to the farmer's market.
Right.
It's a neat.
It lets people pick what they want to. So you don't get a 5 pounds of Brussels sprouts in a box and go, I don't even like Brussels sprouts kind of a thing. So
we were part of a CSA in Vermont, like when we lived up there, I don't know, 5 years ago, 6 years ago. You know, the winter CSA was always nice. You always had some fresh stuff. But I think come January, February, it was like cabbage and rutabagas, and it was just no thanks. Like, and I was laughing with my grandmother about it, and she was telling me all these great ways to cook a rutabaga, and I tried them, and none of them were sufficient for cooking rutabaga. That is a vegetable I will never grow.
We don't grow any of those either. We grow what we like. We kind of made that a thing. We grow the things that we eat, and that way nobody buys it. It's okay. We still have plenty of stuff. We have plenty for us. So
how does that go? You know, figuring out how much food you can take to the farmer's market compared to how much you need to keep and either process down and can and preserve or keep in the fridge for the next week so you can eat fresh food. How does that go?
It's tricky. I tell you, there's that part of the planning is probably the most, it's the most difficult, because the time that you have to do that planning is, you know, over the winter, it's slower, and, you know, you can sit down and have your spreadsheets all ready to go and all that stuff. And I got to plant this stuff this week, and I got to plant this stuff this week, and it rains every week and you don't get to have it planted, and it's difficult. That's probably the most challenging part of the whole thing, really. And then as far as how much to take to the farmer's market, that's tough too, because, you know, they're really cyclical people. You know, a really beautiful sunny day and you think, oh man, everybody's going to be here. And then, you know, the fair's going on that week or whatever else. And people have gone to that. And so trying to figure out how much to take is impossible sometimes.
Yeah, it's kind of, I don't know. I can imagine that would be difficult. We're trying to figure it out kind of for the next, you know, a year from now or 2 years from now, doing a CSA. And how much do I need to plant so that I can have enough for me? And then I need to, how much more do I have to plant on top of that? And trying to figure it all out is tricky. And it's one of those things, I don't think you can figure it out, you know, until you have a couple of years behind you. And even then, like you said, you know, you're ready to plant and then it rains. Or, you know, down here for the last, I don't know, 2 weeks, it's been upper 90s and no rain. And I mean, like, unless you have an irrigation system, you drive down the road and there are fields of corn that are, you know, breast height, and they're just shriveled up and dying because the farmers don't have an irrigation system set up. You know, they're not that big. You know, and what do you, you know, you get stuck when stuff like that happens. What are your plans for expansion then? Are you guys looking at a big field that you're going to till up? Is it wooded type stuff that you're going to have to take care of? Or what are your plans for the next year as you look at it expanding?
Well, we added last year from our original garden, we added a 200 by 60 garden. One bed, and this year we added another 200 by 60. And the ground that we're putting it into is all farm ground. It's been corn and beans for the last since I've ever been around here. So the last 40 or 50 years, it's been corn and beans. So, so it's no woods or anything like that on it. But we planted pasture grass on all the rest of it this year. So our sheep will have something to eat. Then we don't have to buy hay anymore. That'll be awesome. Or at least for the whole year, we won't have to buy hay. But and then we planted extended our orchard too. Our orchard before was kind of random trees wherever we could shove them. And this is a more planned out half an acre orchard, apples and peaches. So that's a retirement project, I hope. That'll be something that we can fund part of our retirement with.
Yeah, trees are tough like that, you know. They put all that money in now and plant them now, and it's going to be a few years before you see anything back from them.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Now, do you do organic type stuff, or you kind of use more of go the conventional route, or...
We talked about it a couple different times doing the certification, because we want to be as organic as we can be, but we have a certain group of bugs here that the Japanese beetles are the worst. You can't plan enough of anything to keep them from eating everything if they decide to show up. So there's got to be some spray for that, and then and certain crops that you grow, coal crops, cabbage worms, and that kind of thing, they're difficult. So we try to just only spray organic sprays, and we've been experimenting with those and found some that are actually really good. They do a really good job. So pretty happy about that. That's basically why we planted the orchard this year. If we wouldn't have been able to find some of those things, we just wouldn't have bothered planting it, because, you know, apple trees and peach trees, are the third thing on the list for the beetles. First is grapes. Second is the apricots or the plums. They tear those trees up, and then they go to the apples, and then they go to the peaches. So,
yeah, I remember as a kid, they were all over. My parents had some grapevines in the backyard, and my brother and I would just go out and pick them off and put them in, like, I don't know, sour cream containers full of God knows what chemicals we used to combine. But you know.
Yeah. Yeah, they're miserable things to deal with, and you know, once they show up, they're there for basically a month, and if you don't do something with them, they'll just defoliate your trees. There won't be any leaves left on them.
How does that work with the new pasture land there, and the new land? Are you guys kind of, I don't know, are you any concerns about how it was farmed beforehand, or are you trying to build the soil up at all, or is kind of gonna work with what you got and go forward with it, or?
Yeah. I think when you go from conventional farming to organic farm, it takes at least 3 years or something like that. I can't remember exactly the numbers, but it's a certain number of years before you could even apply to get certified for it. So, last year we had, just one of our, local farmers plant beans in that area again, just so we wouldn't have to deal with the weeds and all that sort of thing. So we carved a chunk of that ground out and put that first garden in, and then just let them farm that use the money that they paid us for rent to put up the fence for the sheep. So that worked out pretty good. And it's just a matter of time. It's just going to take a little time to get that to heal itself back up, but
it is what it is, and just kind of wait it out and try to help as best you can. If that's what you decide to do, you know, I mean, there's some people that don't decide to do that, and whatever works for you, you know, and your ethic. But so what do you, is your little homestead there self-sustaining when it comes to like finances, or are you guys able to move enough product that you can kind of sustain yourselves, or do you?
Well, not yet. Right now, especially after buying the farm, before we bought that, we were basically debt free. So, I think that's as big a piece of the profitability of the project, whatever you want to do, as anything else is, you know, trying to get your expenses down to a real minimum so you don't need quite as much. That helps a lot. But right now, my job in town takes care of paying for most of the stuff, and we sold twice as much last year as we did the year before. I don't know if we'll do that well this year. We'll double again this year. We're doing a couple extra farmers markets that we hadn't done before, and the co-op is going really good, so we'll see. But we're still a few years away from it being able to sustain itself. But kind of what we're hoping is by the time I get ready to retire, that that'll be a good supplement to our retirement income, and the work keep us from getting too decrepit.
Yeah, you know, there's something to that. There's something to being, keeping yourself active like that, I think.
You know, oh, boy.
You see some older folks out there that you find out how old they are. You're like, really? You know, but they do. They stay active. So hopefully. I can pay attention to as I get older. But I'm kind of curious because you work nights then, right? Is that
right? Yep.
So how does that work when it comes time to gardens and planting stuff and harvesting things and getting to farmers markets and all that stuff? Is that, do you keep a schedule, like a night schedule like that? Or do you kind of flip flop back and forth? Are you?
I work 3 days a week, 3 12-hour days, Saturday, Sunday, or Friday, Saturday, and Sunday nights. So, when I get home on Monday morning, I usually sleep it depends. In the summertime, I have a hard time sleeping when it's nice outside. So maybe 2 or 3 hours on Monday morning, and then I'll be up until bedtime and then just do a normal week. So on Tuesday, I'll probably be up at 6 a.m. and then go till 10 p.m. or whatever and do that through the week. And then Thursday night, I usually try to stay up a little bit extra late so I can sleep later on Friday morning. But Fridays at work suck. By the time 5 o'clock in the morning rolls around, I'm tired and ready to go home. So I sleep basically all day Saturday until it's time to go back to work. And then Sunday, come home, sleep for 2 hours, get up, go to church, come home, sleep for 3 more hours, and then do Sunday night. So it's a ridiculous schedule, but that's part of the deal too. You know, at some point in time, I'm not going to be able to physically do that anymore. So it's a lot harder now than it was 10 years ago when I started it. So one of these days,
It's an impressive schedule. Not gonna lie, that's impressive. And to get up for off 2 hours of sleep, go to church and stay awake, and then come home and sleep some more. It's impressive. That is impressive. with the homeschooling bit, did you guys homeschool all the way through?
John and Heather went to John. He's our oldest. He went to second grade in public school. In Iowa City while Robin was still in school over there. Heather started kindergarten. And then the next year, we put him into a small Christian school while Robin was still going to school. And then once we came back home to Illinois, John and Heather went, I think John went to fourth grade and Heather might have went to second grade for that year, for the rest of that year. And then Robin decided after that she wanted to keep them home. So our first two, most of their career was at home, and our last two, all of theirs were. So Robin's been at that for a long time. She, I think, happy and sad to be done with it of both.
Yeah, I can imagine. It's my kids are, the oldest one is 9, but you know, you see the stages come and go, and glad to be out of some things and sad to be out of them at the same time, you know?
Yep. Yeah. Well, when people ask us about homeschooling, I don't know if there's any better investment that you can make. That's just my opinion on the whole thing. It's a huge investment in time and money, lack of money. Wrote that in our website. Rachel came along. She was a surprise. Robin was in her finishing up her junior year of engineering school at Iowa, and Rachel came along, a big surprise. And there went my bass boat. There went my sugar mom wanting to buy me cool stuff, like a new bass boat and stuff like that, with her big engineer job. No more of that.
It is though, you know, I mean, that's, I don't know. It's one of those things, you know, you can, it's an investment in your children, and, what more investment can you make? You know, what bigger investment can you make?
You really can't. I don't think you can. It's an awesome thing, and it's neat to see it on the, from the backside too, from being done with it. You know, our kids all enjoy each other. I mean, they still spend time together all the time. You know, John's in his early 30s and Sam is, I think he's going to be 21 this year, and they spend most of their free time together just doing stuff. And it's fun to watch. It's fun to see them all together.
That's cool. When you guys were making that decision, the homesteading, the kind of homeschooling and keeping it all kind of home centered there, was that something you guys kind of did on purpose, or was it just, you know, the same sort of feelings that, you know, the same reason that you want to be able to grow your own food, you kind of wanted to, you know, teach your kids at the same time? Or
no, it didn't really work out that way for us. We were still, I still had a different kind of job than I have now. I was gone traveling quite a bit and that sort of thing. And we had a big mortgage and a really nice house in town and that sort of thing. And it was a good life. It wasn't bad, but it was just different. And the homeschooling came because Robin, you know, she got done going to school herself, and she's sitting around the house going, oh, what am I going to do? What do you want me to do? I got these babies to take care of, and they're not going to daycare. We did that for a little while, and we're not doing that anymore. So she was trying to figure out what, you know, she needed to be doing. And so that's how that came about. And then, you know, my jobs were basically I needed a job that gave us a two-income job, you know what I mean? Compared to our friends who, you know, decided to go a different way, and you know, they didn't need the as much money or, you know, that sort of thing. So I worked a lot. And when we decided to move out of town and move out here, that was a kind of a, that was a decision that we made, that we wanted to be able to slow down a little bit and not have to run quite so hard, because we were going like crazy in town, and that wasn't healthy either.
Yeah, no, it's something my wife and I talk about frequently, you know, how can we slow things down? You know, you don't want to deprive your kids of different outlets, you know?
Sure.
But at the same time, like, you know, going here and there and here and there and back to here, it's just, that's not good either, you know? So trying to find that balance is tricky when they're younger, you know?
Yeah. It doesn't get any easier when they get a little older. I mean, it's, you know,
Yeah. All right. Well, I appreciate your time. That was a little conversation there. It's a pretty unique setup. I like that. It's, I don't know. I like that hybrid kind of co-op-y CSA type thing. So,
yeah.
But yeah, thanks, coming on and sharing. Is there, if somebody wants to, order some of your coffee, or, if they're in the area and they want to find some of what you're selling there at the farmer's market, where might they find that?
We do a farmer's market in Aledo, one in East Moline, Illinois. We do one on Saturday morning in Muscatine, Iowa, and another one on Thursday afternoons in Bettendorf, Iowa. We're right on the border of Illinois and Iowa, so that's part of the reason that we have both. So, but our bigger cities to the north and west are across the river. So that's kind of how we go there. And then we're in a pretty small community. I think there's less than 20,000 people in our county. So, but to the north and to the west of us, there's bigger cities. So that's where most of our stuff goes to. But there's that. And then we have our website available for Broken Shovel Coffee. You can just Google that and find it. That's how we do it.
All right. I will put the links there to the coffee in the show notes. So if anybody wants to find some of your coffee, that's where they will find the link.
Yep. One of these days, Daniel's going to come and do a video. He wanted to do it a while back, and I'm like, man, I don't know, dude. Outside, it's kind of weird. So at some point we'll be able to put some kind of, actually show people how it's done, because it's fun. It's a fun hobby, really. I think it's a good hobby. Doesn't cost much to do it, to start it, and something fun you can do for yourself.
It sounds really interesting. It sounds very, I don't know, one of those things, like a really fun hobby, you know, where it's just kind of, you're not just spending money on a bass boat flying up and down the river. You're you know,
yeah,
you're doing something that's I don't know,
yeah,
meeting a personal need.
And then when the hobby turns into a business, then you can start deducting your receipts at Starbucks for quality control and market research.
I like that. That's a good method. I like that. Do you love freedom? Do you love songs? Do you want to love all 365 days in a year? If you're anything like me, the simple answer is yes. And Freedom Song 365 can deliver all of these things. When you sign up for Freedom Song 365, you'll receive an email every day that delves into the different ways freedom and liberty are messaged in a massive catalog of music. Each message is carefully crafted into easily consumable paragraphs that give you the necessary information to share with your friends. I've been receiving Freedom Song 365 emails every day of 2019, and I've yet to be disappointed. But really, why should I be? With the fabulous minds of Nikki P from the Sounds Like Liberty podcast, my guest from episode 4, Sherry Voluntary, and the wonderful Luke Tatum of the Culture of Peace podcast, there's more brain power utilized in the creation of each individual Freedom Song 365 email than is proffered in a whole day at any DMV across the country. Head on over to freedomsong365.com and sign up today to start receiving your daily emails of musical integrity. Use the promo code HOMESTEAD and you'll receive 15% off the superb service. Again, that's freedomsong365.com, promo code HOMESTEAD for 15% off. Now, don't you want to go roast some coffee? Go get some beans, roast some coffee, put some plants in the ground and go sell them at the farmer's market. I love talking to people. It's inspiring, and there's so many different techniques and different ways to do things out there. And it's really been great being able to talk to people and get that all in my head. If you've been enjoying the show, please go out and share it with a friend, share it with a family member, leave a review on iTunes or Stitcher, wherever you listen to podcasts, I guess. Big shout out to everyone that has done that and to the folks that support me on Patreon. That's huge, guys. Thank you. And if you would like to support the show, as well, you can do that on Patreon, patreon.com/theLibertyHippie. This is all for today. Trying to keep it shorter. Yeah. Go join the Facebook group, the Homestead at Homeschool Forum. It's growing slowly. It's growing, but, you know, just poke your face in there and who knows what you might find. And feel free to reach out to me at homesteadsandhomeschools@gmail.com. You know, give me some feedback, any guest ideas, anything you'd like to see or hear. I'm all ears. I'm willing to listen. In fact, that is how I came across Mike, Dan Schmatz over at Goulash Media, the guy that made the little Homesteads and Homeschools icon. He pointed me in Mike's direction. So thank you for that, Dan. So without further ado, get out there. Sow those seeds of liberty. We can all reap seeds of freedom together. I'm gonna ride a hustler's dream.